climate change may have contributed to the emergence of the fungal pathogen Candida auris. Welcome to Microbial Minutes. This is ASM's update on what's hot in the microbial sciences, the It's Getting Hot in Ear edition. I'm Julie Wolf, Science Communication Specialist here at ASM, and we'll be focusing on a paper that was recently published within ASM's MBio journal, which you can find at mbio.asm.org. And of course, we'll link to it below. In this paper, the scientists have suggested the interesting hypothesis that climate change may have contributed to the emergence of Candida auris. Now, we've spoken a lot about Candida auris on our Microbial Minutes in the last couple of months. This is a recently emerged fungal pathogen, first identified in 2009 from a human ear, and that ear location is going to be important later on in our discussion here. However, there were several independent lineages of Candida auris that emerged around this same time period. They were found in Venezuela, India, South Africa, and all of these were genetically independent clades. And so the question that this group is investigating is why? Why would all of a sudden this new fungal pathogen emerge independently rather than being traveled, perhaps emerging once and moving around the world? It seems to have emerged all at once from in several different places. Several people have suggested that the use of azoles have selected for this multi-drug-resistant fungal pathogen, and it's possible that the use of azoles in places like agriculture have contributed to its resistant phenotype, but generally, being drug-resistant does not confer the ability to cause disease or confer virulence to a microbe. And so this group wanted to focus a little more on another trait of this fungus, which is its thermotolerance. The ability to grow at 37 degrees Celsius, which is the internal temperature of most mammals, is really unusual among fungi. Most fungal species around the world grow at lower temperatures, and thus they can grow and colonize and be pathogens of other types of organisms, such as reptiles, fish, even plants have a number of fungal pathogens, a much higher proportion relative to humans, which tend to have pathogens that are bacteria, viruses, and protozoans. In this case, they wanted to look at the thermotolerance of Candida auris relative to many of its cousins, many of its fungal cousins. And this isn't the first time that this group of scientists have looked at the role of temperature in fungal pathogenesis. In fact, Arturo Casadevall, the first author here, has suggested that fungi may have selected for the mammalian ability to have that high internal temperature and thus avoid predation and disease mediated by those fungi, allowing mammals to become one of the dominant species or dominant types of animals on Earth. Now, on the next page, we'll see the analysis that they did looking at Candida auris and many of its different fungal cousins, as I mentioned. Now, they looked at a whole bunch of these, which are shown in that little thumbnail, but I wanted to blow up so you could really see the Candida auris data. And this is they pulled from other places. They didn't run all of the growth curves and temperature tests themselves, but they did this analysis based on many other types of experiments that have been done by other experts in the field. Candida auris is at the top there, and you can see they're looking at growth of all of these different fungal species at 25 degrees Celsius, which is around room temperature. In the middle, there's 37 degrees Celsius, which, as I mentioned, is the internal temperature of most mammals. And then 45 degrees Celsius is what is shown on the very right-hand side. And no fungi can grow at that very high temperature. And among these that are shown in the top part of the graph, only Candida auris is able to grow at that 42 degrees Celsius, the second highest temperature which was tested, which is about 107 degrees Fahrenheit. Imagine a really terrible fever in mammals. So this tree shows that Candida auris is capable of growing at higher temperatures, but it does not show when this trait was acquired. And that's an important caveat in this in their conclusion, because we don't know whether this ability to grow at higher temperature was something that has been selected by an increasing temperature around the globe, which is something that all of those different clades would have experienced, or if there was another factor at play. Another important caveat is to point out that many of the Candida auris isolates, which have been found to colonize people, have been found on the skin, such as on the ear I mentioned at the beginning. That's where the first Candida auris isolate was found. And the temperature of the skin is slightly lower than our internal temperature, such as the gastrointestinal tract. It's like 30 or 32 degrees Celsius instead of, say, 37. And so this may suggest that although Candida auris can withstand that high temperature, this is not the preferred temperature of the fungus. However, this was picked up, this article was picked up by a number of different news outlets. We'll look at those on the next slide. It was picked up by mainstream outlets, by technical outlets, the first author, Casadevall, was quoted saying that the most mystifying aspect of the emergence of Candida auris as a human pathogen is that it appeared in three different continents at roughly the same time, and that the three isolates are genetically distant. This implies some common trigger in geographically distant sites, and given that climate change is occurring globally, we decided to focus on that variable. This is very possible, and it will require new studies that identify things such as the natural niche and the environmental reservoir of Candida auris in order to really determine whether climate change is what has selected for this as a human pathogen. This study comes on the heels of a consensus statement which was published in Nature Reviews Microbiology, which involved a consortium of scientists calling attention to the role of microbes in climate change, which is often ignored. Hopefully, stories such as this one in MBio, which involve infectious disease, will bring attention to the role of microbes, which play a huge role in the global cycling of many of the important elements that will be affected by climate change. And we'll link to both the MBio and this Nature Reviews Microbiology piece down below. Today we've talked about how climate change may affect microbial processes and species, and it may be an underlying cause of the emergence of Candida auris as a human pathogen. If you want to find out more about how climate change and microbes and all of these different processes interact, be sure to hit subscribe so you never miss a Microbial Minutes. I'd like to thank Ray Ortega for production, and thank you for listening. I'm Julie Wolf, and I'll be with you next time on Microbial Minutes.